about Ehime. This is Japan. The Tokyo is here. So this is small island called Shikoku Island. My entire study in Osaka is here.
Yes, it's
Tokyo is capital. And small island, our city is here. So Ehime prefecture. So Japan has 49 prefectures, and each prefecture has at least one national university. Then Ehime prefecture has Ehime University, which is national university of this prefecture, located in Matsuyama City. This is the capital city in this prefecture. And population size is about 500,000. Then this island is connected to this main island, connected to three bridges, so we can access by even by car or train. But usually I use drive. I often meet in Tokyo Airport using the flight. Then, for example, to go to Manila, to go to Matsuyama City from Manila, there is an international flight to Tokyo or Osaka, then you can fly to Matsuyama. So only one connection. The orange is very famous. Then this south area, Shikoku and Kyushu Island, are warmer than north, so you do not see snow, fortunately or unfortunately. I live in Sendai for 11 years when I was a university student with my wife, very different food. And after Sendai, I transferred to Germany, Berlin, for hospital. Berlin was also very, very cold. So, actually, current place is my first place to live in Bombay. Of course, colder than here, but warmer than North Korea. Then, several historical things. This is Matsuyama Castle, historical castle. Then, about my laboratory, molecular ecology and health laboratory called MECO lab. And molecular genetics, we use DNA, RNA, protein techniques. So two topics are running. Freshwater biodiversity. We use usually use streaming. And population genomics. I talk about this one, adaptive divergence today. And also metabarcoding. And recently we are also doing DNA-based taxonomics. I'm not a taxonomist. However, collaborating with taxonomists, and we provide some evidence, molecular-based evidence for the description of new species. And also, we are recently doing EDN project, environmental DNA, just collecting water samples to estimate biodiversity in the environment. And today, I don't talk. However, epidemiology or dengue. Dengue study is also one of the main topics. Prediction model for under climate change scenario using machine learning techniques and population genetics. So we genotype mosquitoes collected from Metro-Manila here to the estimation of migration pattern. Or viral detection. Or we are also doing gene expression analysis. We are comparing the gene expression pattern between virally infected and non-infected mosquitoes. We are comparing to identify important genes related to viral infection. Then this is our current laboratory members, about 20. A Filipino, 5. Plus 1 is my wife. My wife is also that. Indonesia, Venezuela, Romania, Taiwan, Mozambique, and Japan. Currently, Japan is the top country. But I think next year, this year, if all of new positions are distributed, if three positions are occupied by Filipino, then Filipino become A, then become a top. Then actually, I have Filipino. I'm already eating my wife's food. But maybe I can come 1 2 years. I can move. By the way, many Filipinos is there. He finished his PhD last year, September. He stayed in Manila for 4 years, and I was doing postdoc fellowship program for the coming two years. So he's a pioneer of DNA study. Then 1, 2, 3, and 4. She's from UPLB. To many Filipinos. This is the outline of my book. I prepared two research topics. One is related to metabarcoding using MGS, and second one is genome analysis. Then, finally, I'd like to talk about more detail about my laboratory, and also the three new positions, available positions in my laboratory. The first topic is metabarcoding. Ecological influence of cellular fibers on the macroinvasive dance fragment fevers by DNA metabarcoding. This study has been already published last year. Jose, he is from Lasalle University, and doing now PhD in my laboratory under motion studies. And this is actually this project has been conducted in Swiss, not in Japan. And sediment bypass tunnel. So this is done. And so done. Accumulate many sediment in the reservoir. Then reduce their capacity to storage water. Therefore, need to maintain active storage capacity. Then transport. So we need to transport this sediment from up to downstream flood of the river. Then this SDG is recently proposed, and the currently testing the technology to transport sediment from here to here, like this tunnel. Then during the flood, only flood. During flood events, sediment are transported to the downstream. So this is actually a map of up down with SDT in Swiss. This is here is downside, and this is lake. Then tunnel is here, and this is outlet of the SDT. So SDT is expected to recover the storage capacity of the reservoir. However, at the same time, it is expected to recover biodiversity in the outlet of the reservoir. Because usually dam outlet site, because of the reduction of the sediment amount and also change of sediment site distribution. Usually, biodiversity of aquatic organisms is reduced. However, if we can provide sediment to the dam outlet, we can expect to recover the sediment condition, therefore, recovery of biodiversity is also expected. However, this SVD technology is very new, therefore, nobody has tested the ecological recovery function of the SVT. Therefore, our team try to test this ecological positive influence of SVT using DNA metabarcoding. What is metabarcoding? Probably most of them know DNA barcoding. DNA barcoding is we are targeting not microorganisms like bacteria or something. We are using aquatic insects for the biodiversity assessment. However, small, similar morphology between different species, and we have to hand process any sample to time-consuming misidentification and low resolution. Most of the time, we cannot identify a species data. We have to give up a genus or family level. And however, if we obtain So this, we have bird community samples. We don't know the name of the species of these samples. Then we collect these community samples from the field and homogenize community to be like meat. Then extract DNA from this community sample. Then prepare community DNA cocktail and amplify some specific gene. Usually we for macro invert project we use CO1 region, mitochondrial CO1 region. Then amplify them. Then we give sequence using the NGS. Then we can quickly obtain the sequence data of the samples included in the community sample. So simultaneous parallel processing of sequence analysis for large number of individuals can be done. This is one of the advantages of metabarcoding. Then go back to the project, SBD project in the Swiss. So SBD, currently SBD has been installed to 11 plants in the world. 3 Swiss, 7, 4 Swiss, 6 Japan, and 1 Taiwan. Only 3 countries. Then, because I don't want to work in Japan, therefore I targeted Swiss SBD dams. So we targeted 3 dams with SBD in Swiss. And these 3 SBD have a different age. 1 SBD, 92 years old. Very old. However, 92. However, this solid dam, there are this dam only 2 years. They are SBD dam. It's only 2 years old. Can we sample something? Dam is for 20 years old. However, recently SBD has attached to the dam. Then we collected the samples from here, upper side of SBD inlet and outlet. And we also collected macro inverse samples before the outlet of SBD, below the ESD. However, out of the 3 dams, one dam, their outlet of SBD located here. So we in this time, we do not collect EC and ESD. Then we collected the rabbit from river. Then not only the 3 SBD dams, we also collected for the comparison, we collected samples from dam fragment river without SBD. And for further comparison, we also collected samples, deep flowing, that means low dam. So there are 3 types, dam with SBD, dam without SBD, and low dam rivers. 3 types. So in total, many samples. 18 or 16 sites we collected. 16. Then this is the result of metabarcoding. Sorry, this is too small. About 2.2 million leads were obtained from NGS analysis. Then about 2.2 million, 1.9 million were accepted by the quality check, quality filtering. Then 0.2 million were discarded. Then, blue is in terms of leaf, and OT is the number of operations that are increasing. So the quality of the data was quite good for the analysis. Then, this is interesting result. Annex is a total sample. So before doing MGS analysis or genetic analysis, we morphologically identify. Then this is for each plot, and each plot indicates taxon. Then it's total abundance of this taxon. And y-axis indicates total sequence abundance. That means number of sequences obtained from NGS. So number of NGS leads and abundance counted by morphological analysis shows good positive correlation. So if so that means this species or taxa have many number of individuals. Therefore, recovered number of sequences from this taxa one time. Positive correlation. And this is a taxonomic assignment result. So we identify, based on metabarcoding, we identify 131 species from 36 families. However, most of the leads, 46 leads, about half leads, were identified, assigned to these adults. This is very abundant and famous species in the adults, this one. However, like 131 is quite high number for the biodiversity. Then using the species composition data obtained from metabarcoding, we assess the influence of SVD or DAM. And this is the most important result from this project. And we calculated beta diversity, great part of this similarity index between two sites, how defined in their species composition are. Great part is. And this is DAM fragmented. And without DAM, without SVD, fragment, DAM fragmented with SVD. And free growing, no DAM. Then, from the comparison of red and green, as we expected, DAM fragment river show larger species difference between up and down fragment. As compared to free growth, is expected with that. And DAM fragmented, some DAM show, for example, this DAM, up and down, their species composition becomes similar. However, some DAM didn't get similar. The pattern of the change of species composition after the installation of SVD were different among three SVD dams. The sum down worked, sum down didn't work well with SVD installation. Okay, one of the potential explanations is operation time. Actually, these solids dam, this dam, just recently, 2 years ago, SVD has been installed. The x-axis indicates a lower log transform operation time of SVD. Then y is great axis. So there are negative correlations. So older SVD tends to decrease great axis. This is similarity. That explain that we need several or maybe 10, more than 10 years to see the recovery of biodiversity under down fragment size. And this is a summary. We are able to use DNA metabarcoding, metachromic fluorescence, and macro metabarcoding by some kind of species, regeneration and diversity, and calculate committee this similarity between upstream and downstream side of seven algorithms. Then we report a positive influence of SVD operation macro and downstream of the outlet at two rivers, which are B bigotry order SDE. This simulator observes for upstream and downstream sites are solid. This is a new SDE data. While bigotry is similar to the downstream site, or even higher than the other size. Significant here some correlation between breakers dissimilarity and SVT population years was observed. The distance between the number of community of the up and downstream side decreased with increasing population time. So this is our final conclusion. So metabarcoding. Based on our experience, metabarcoding was very powerful. When we conduct this kind of biodiversity assessment in abroad, for example, when I did postdoc in Germany, I also morphologically assessed the biodiversity of stream insects. However, most of literature or books are written in German or in Italy. I couldn't believe. However, this project we didn't use. We asked our collaborator in Switzerland. And we did not identify the species. We just did identification of quantity data for genus development. However, a metabarcoding was species level identification. Then we could show a good example how metabarcoding can work in this kind of metabarcoding based on biodiversity assessment in abroad. The second topic, I move to second topic, genome analysis. I say the difference of NGS analysis. The metabarcoding analysis is, if we have many samples, we target only small region of the genome, then amplify and analyze all of the samples. However, genome analysis is opposite way. We just go use one or several individuals only. However, we need genome only. But we cannot analyze many samples. Difference is sample size and target region size. So the second topic is data example. Why? But smaller samples. The Swiss project, we analyze more than 6,000 individuals. However, genome analysis we cannot do analyze such a large number. The genome-wide simulation of local adaptation among the seven comprised species. This stream insect, this one, along nationwide of Brazilian gradient in Japan. And this was recently published in BMC Genomics. Dr. Mari Bench, she's my postdoc. And Lare, maybe some of you know Lare. Maria Clareto Tsuchiya. I met her last week, and I hear that she is now staying in Ehime University with her student. And yesterday, she came to my home then, for a party with my wife. I combine the result of from two papers. First of all, this one is about genomics, and also they did tropion analysis using same software samples, equivalent in protein expression and five species of stone. So I mixed these two results in my talk. In Japan, snowflake is quite abundant and diverse. anyway, usually they have to live in a cold area. Then this is so the genetic divergence. So we use the genomic technique to see genetic divergence patterns of aqua keeping fish. This is my paper. And no. Adaptive divergence along narrow environment gradient in post-stream insects. So from insects, there are many genomic based evidences of local adaptation. And this project, I collected genome-wide data from four species, and also I collected environmental data, like water quality and temperature and landscape data. Then I found that all of the four species that I genetically analyzed, the environmental factor that is causing local adaptation of each species, the environmental factor are limiting environmental factor of their habitat distribution. For example, this species, 1, 2, 3, 4 species, this species, their habitat distribution is controlled or determined by altitude elevation. Then most strong or important environmental factor causing local adaptation based on genomic analysis was also elevation among the 20 environmental variables that I analyzed. So all the four species, the factors are defined. This is water, property A, POM, particle organic matter, and this is elevation. Environmental factors are different. However, all of the four species show the same pattern. Limiting habitat distribution factor also limit or cause local adaptation. So this is the aim of this general type analysis is the influence of environmental condition on the genome and the biological response of natural population, determining the degree of co-adaptation of multiple species by genome similarities. Then we collected stonefly samples throughout Japan, Hokkaido, cold area, like this. Sendai, Ike, and Matsuyama, like this. So we set a climatic gradient or summer gradient in the four regions. From the each region, we collected from different locations, the river. Then we also measured several environmental variant factors, altitude, precipitation, water level, discharge, water temperature, air temperature, and snow cover. Then finally, we could collect genes 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 species commonly occur throughout the whole region in Japan. Then we targeted these 7 species for genomic analysis. Therefore, genome-wide sequence analysis. We analyzed about 290 individual samples. So there are 7 species. So per species is about 30. About 30 to 40 individuals were analyzed per species. Then the DNA extracted. Then we made concentration. Then we used double digest distribution associated DNA, DDRC analysis. Getting some popular method for genome sequence. This is this analysis cannot get full genome sequence of the individual. However, we can obtain between 10 to 30% of genome sequence data. For many, not so many, but between less than 100 individuals in one NGS. Less proportion of genome sequence, however, we can in parallel analyze. But this is a concept of the deep blood thing. So we cut the genome, then adapter ligation, we attach adapter to recognize individual. So we change the sequence of this adapter for each individual. Then prepare a diagnostic library and run on MGS. We use high speed machine. Then also we did proteome analysis to identify expressed proteins. Then protein extracted, the major protein, then we did vector process analysis like this. Then we pick up only locally unique protein that occurs only one region, out of the whole region, or the protein sequence analysis. Then from the protein sequence data, we identify the name of protein and their function. Then this is the result of lab seq analysis. 7 species. Then from the lab seq analysis, this analysis we run four times of NGS data. Then from the NGS data, we identify single nucleus polymorphic. Many SNPs were found from the NGS data. Then from SNPs, using some modeling analysis, we identify candidate SNPs under global adaptation. So there are SNPs have two types, neutral SNPs and adaptive SNPs, non-neutral SNPs. So we separated these two types using this model. And then, so this identification of candidate SNP, we didn't use any environmental data. Then after that, we combined these candidate SNP sequence data with environmental data, like temperature and precipitation data, then finally identified adaptive SNPs, which are statistically correlated to environmental data. A is altitude, B is precipitation, something like that. And this number indicates number of adaptive SNPs correlated to altitude. Then most of the species show good strong correlation for adaptation to altitude and precipitation. So altitude is often reported as an important local adaptation factor to adaptive insects. However, precipitation. Probably precipitation can change the physical environment, like flow, current velocity, or sediment size distribution of river. This physical environment affects some adaptive process of these stonefly species. Then we also did some statistical analysis, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 species. Then each drop individual from four colored region. Then we can see some species, for example this one, and show very clear regional pattern of adaptive divergence. So blue, Sapporo are here, and warm is here. So that means, and this axis indicates water temperature. So this adaptive divergence pattern were determined by the water temperature of the river. Altitude, water temperature, and precipitation. So the determinant factor of environment. start to grow here or kind of like this. Based on our identification analysis, we identify important function of protein expressed in each region. Sapporo, North area, cold area, oxygen regulation, and we must win development in Sendai, second forest, and Gifu, cell regulation, and Matsuyama, low area, cell damage, and repair. So, the important protein-based function are different among four regions. And overall, cold temperature tends to reduce oxygen radiation, and warmer temperature like material this area induce metabolic proteins. The summary. So from genomic, we identify SNPs associated to precipitation and altitude from the seven species. And from protein analysis, we could also identify functions of protein related to climatic variables. Before my laboratory, about Matsuyama City. Matsuyama City is a local city. University is located in the center of the city. Then you don't need to buy car or you don't need to use public transportation. What you need is only bicycle. If you have a bicycle, you can access most of the things in the city. Then cost, living cost. For your apartment.
Yes, sensei.
It's 30,000 yen. It's about 150 yen. So 1 yen is no.
100 yen, sensei.
Now?
100 yen, sensei.
No. What is the rate of 10 yen?
Almost half. 0.4.
2 yen is 1 peso. 2 yen is 1
peso.
Yes, 1 yen is 0.5.
Yes.
Then war.
Oh,
and
no,
many flights. Then currently, our laboratory has 4 postdocs and 6 PhD students, masters and undergraduate, and exchange students. So one of the big advantage if you will study my group, one of the big advantages is many postdocs and students. That means you have a good opportunity to discuss or to collaborate with other young scientists. And also, very internationalized research, research group. This is, our group is the most internationalized research group in the university, in the university. So you don't need to use Japanese, for example. English is okay. He can speak Japanese very well. Although he's staying for 4 years. He can speak. Many projects are running in the Philippines and also Indonesia. Philippines about 5 years, Indonesia also 3 years. Main collaborator is the Asal University and also researching the tropical density. Expand on two cities are also my main research in Indonesia. Then this is currently I'm seeking for three PhD students using newly awarded research grant from Sumitomo Electronic Research Company for 5 years. This program will ecological control of mosquito communities in Southeast Asia. This starts from this entry. For 5 years, 7 25, so this is about 30 or 40 million pesos. And research unit program, this is internal research grant from Ehime University. This is also approved 2 years ago. And research in environmental health study in Southeast Asia. These two programs can support these activities and education of students. For example, if you will be a PhD student in my group, you can go to fieldwork to the Philippines. Most of my Philippines, all of my Filipino students, they did fieldwork in the Philippines. However, they can analyze or they can other work can be done in Japan. So you can combine your working time in the Philippines and Japan during your PhD study in Japan. And also, PhD students have a chance to do internship in Europe or USA for 1 or 2 months. So, because of my experience in Germany for 3 years, of course, your experience studying in Japan is overseas experience or international experience. However, we are both very similar. Japan and Philippines both are Asia. For the real experience, you should see Western countries, culture, and their level of research. Therefore, I'm always encouraging young scientists and students to study in Western countries. So, for this internship, you will have additional financial support from our laboratory. For example, Jose is my PhD student from Nassau University. Last month, he stayed in Berlin, Germany for 6 weeks. Then did internship. Then he also joined a research project in Germany. Then he did plankton quality metabarcoding analysis in a lake in Berlin. About the announcement of the three positions, PhD positions. The PhD candidate can be either or both research area of vector one and freshwater biodiversity, both, or each, either of them. Then, probably most of them will use the molecular techniques. So, if you are interested in running good energy. The application deadline is March 2019 or field up. So if probably if you apply around end of March, maybe too late. Yesterday I interviewed many students already. And next one I got Indonesia for interview in Indonesia. So if you decide to study in Japan or my laboratory, please apply as soon as possible. Then hopefully I'll come back here in March for interview for Japan. Then full financial support will be covered by this program. So you don't need to pay anything, including grant. For 5 years. Then, I like to work, not only me, all professors in the world like to work hard, independent work. So I also like to work such kind of work. Then this is just a model of the schedule. So now is 2019. Then the total duration is 4.5 years. However, as a PhD student, you can stay only for 3 years. But before PhD, you stay as a research student. But anyway, both types of students, you don't need to take any courses, just do research. Then from research student period, you can start with your PhD. However, then you can include the data from research student period into the PhD. So actual period of PhD study is 4.5 years, just a change of status. Then you take entrance examination 1 or 2 months before the entrance of PhD program, entrance examination. But entrance examination is only interview based with me. I'm taking exam. So it's kind of ceremony. A PhD degree, it's important. You need to have 3 passport papers. This is a big reason that you need to have research student here. 3 years is sometimes risky. 3 months before your graduation. Then this is an example of PhD thesis chapters. So if you can publish 2 papers and 1 paper accepted, you can graduate. You have PhD degree. Then you can use the published paper as 1 chapter in your PhD thesis. And of course, you can include manuscript submitted under review or even under preparation as an additional chapter. Then if you have 5 papers and manuscripts, include them, then you can cover with a general introduction and general conclusion. So probably in the beginning, usually you have to write your original PhD thesis. However, in my laboratory, all of these things that I don't request to make original PhD, just combine, concentrate on making good produce and journal papers. This will help also in your future. After your PhD, you have to get good positions. Then assignment is between 60 to 70 Philippine pesos per month. This is 70,000. I cannot provide 70,000. Yes, it's too much. 70,000 is almost the same cost, same price for longshot for Japanese government scholarship. So final condition is very similar, or very good. Then this is a student right. But we have a weekly seminar. One person from our group, or sometimes we invite external speaker. Usually intern, one person need to level their progress. The field work, laboratory work. The many Filipinos, Kazuki, Williams, Rale, Tsuchiya-san, Kumarajan. Here. This is my home. Why my wife is here. So my wife is very good doctor. She's from Pampanga. Pampanga. So she took and started Filipino, not only Filipino students, to international students. Then summer campaign, popular laboratory summer campaign, and cherry blossom. Sakura festival. So you can also enjoy Japanese culture. This is real final slide. And if you have PhD degree, you have also a chance to be postdoctoral fellow of Japanese government, GSDS. This is like DOS, not DOS here. But this is a funding agency of Japanese government, Japan Society for the Promotion of Science. 1 to 2 years, usually 2 years. You can choose duration of fellowship. The stipend is good. Better than me, better than my salary.
Better than
but very good. And also, you have research budget, which you can use for traveling to attend no 8 years, so within 6 years you have to start. That means within 5 years you have to apply, because the result of that your application will come after 1 year. 5 years. So you have to find, of course, you have to find a Japanese professor to be your postdoc. Of course, you can. I'm always happy to be your postdoc. However, if you want to study another topic in Japan, you should find a Japanese professor. And if you are shy, sorry, I can't take too much Japanese professor. And however, you have to have many publications. Many publications. How many when you apply?
Right.
Before you apply.
When you apply.
18 sensei.
18 publications. I think less than 5, no chance. 10, you have chance. So far, I posted 3 postdoc fellows. 18. 22 and 15 newspapers they have already applied. So if you have 10 publications, not to necessarily to be first author, sponsorship paper is also, then impact factor is not so important. Number of publications. If you have more than 10, please sponsor to apply for this post mentorship. Or please announce to a young scientist to apply for this post mentorship.